Hi. This is Blackbox. And even though you see me triggering samples and clips, sort of like Ableton Live's session view, this is standalone hardware that can sample, sequence, live loop, time stretch, and more. Let's check it out. Let's start with a look at the hardware and then dive into the details. The body is sturdy metal and the knobs are very solid. Front and center is a very large, clear, and responsive touch LCD display. The four encoders help you change and edit items on different screens. Encoders feel very sturdy and their motion is nicely tuned to give you good control over whatever it is that they're assigned to control on screen. The transport buttons are fairly straightforward: record, stop, and play, though they have slightly different functions depending on whether you're in song mode or not, or if you're sampling, more on that later. And there are 8 navigation buttons to move between the main functional screens. The info button always lets you drill down on a certain item. So for example, if I select this pad and I want to look into it, I press info and then I can move between its screens back and forth using the info and back buttons. Despite its relatively small size, it has a plethora of connectivity options with MIDI in and out, TRS, clock in and out, 8 mono or 4 stereo outputs, 4 selectable, and then all the audio goes out through the headphone output, and thank you very much, a USB MIDI host jack, which means you can connect and power USB MIDI devices directly without going through a separate USB hub or MIDI host device. Blackbox is powered via the USB jack, so you can use any power brick to power it on the go, though you'll need to make sure you have enough juice if you want to also power a MIDI controller with it. It sends and accepts audio at eurorack level, so you may need a mixer to attenuate the audio coming out. An interesting twist on the audio inputs and outputs is that they are DC coupled, meaning that they can be used to sample and play back control voltage, and perhaps in the future also generate sequenced CV and gate signals to control eurorack gear. To complete the external tour of the hardware, we have a micro SD card slot up front. You need that to save and load samples and projects. Now, to really get to know Blackbox, we need to dive into the pads, sequences, and song pages or screens. The other ones are really straightforward. You've got simple keys to play samples. You've got effects to control the effects for the different pads, effect sends, delay and reverb currently, mix control, both panning and levels on a per pad basis. Presets, which are basically states of the machine. You can easily save and load those presets. And then a few more miscellaneous settings and tools. So let's start with the basic building block of a project or preset in Blackbox, which is pads. The idea behind pads is simple. Each pad has one sample. Right? Now these samples can be one shots, but they can also be loops or entire songs. The file limit is about 4 gigabytes, and you can load up any WAV file into this. Files are streamed from the SD card. I tried this out. I streamed multiple very large files. It worked pretty nicely alongside beats playing one shot samples. Loading up samples is quite easy. I'll start with a new preset or new project, load it up, and then just pick any slot I want. And when you click info, you can either sample audio coming in, we'll do that in a bit, or just load a file from the SD card. You can see traveling through the SD card is quite simple. Just pick, let's say this, and you can preview files. Really simple. Let's load up a simple bass. And we just populated this pad. Now, like I said before, you can also load up loops. So if I go back here and look for, let's say, just this guy, for example, or anyone else. Right, slow this one. So now we have a loop in this pad and we can just play that back as well. So each pad can hold one sample as long as you want. Quite simple. However, Blackbox can treat these samples in one of 3 different ways. They can be treated as a sample, a clip, or a sliced sample or slicer. More on these types in a bit. Before we dive into that, let's look at a few global parameters that apply to all types of samples. They can either be played monophonically or polyphonically, depending on the limitations of the different sample types, and you can choose which output they're played out of. So all samples get played out the headphone output, but in addition, you can choose to have them go out of one of the 6 mono outputs or one of the 3 stereo outputs. Blackbox, by the way, handles both stereo and mono samples. Beside that, there are additional parameters. I won't go over all of these, but basically you've got pitch control, level, you've got both a high pass and low pass filter. In one direction, it becomes a high pass filter, and in the other, a low pass filter. There's no resonance control on this, but maybe it will be added later on. You've got ADSR controls and a few other parameters, like for example, playing in reverse, which isn't too dramatic in the case of this particular sample. And then you have control over how this pad will be treated by incoming MIDI. So by default, if we go back to the original project, every key will play a different pad. However, if I just wanted to, say, play this sample chromatically, I could go in and then choose to have it respond to, say, MIDI channel 1. And then if I set my key step to MIDI channel 1, I'll be able to play this sample chromatically. By the way, if you want, keys can also be used to trigger or turn off different sequences. All right, so this will trigger this one. Then this will do this one, and so on. Last thing I think that's worth mentioning, relevant to all sample types, is that you can also choose to have them play in choke groups. So exclusive X means that all the pads can play, and then you've got 4 choke groups where only one sample in the choke group can play at any given time. Okay, so let's go over the 3 sample types and see what's special about each one. Let's start with sample. Sample is designed more for one-shot type of samples. It has the ability to loop samples as well. So if I just play this sample outright, right? That's how it is in memory. You can go ahead and turn on looping, either forward or bidirectional, but let's just do forward for now. And then once you do that, you've got these looping points that appear on the sample. Now it's pretty tricky to find looping points that sound good. There's some clicking. I think it would be nice if they added some sort of fading here. But with some work, you can find these spots. You can always zoom in and look closer and try to find spots which are the same level or zero crossing. Let's try maybe here. All right. It's not that easy, but if you mess around with it, you can try and make something work. Now, aside from letting you set loop points and the ability to play in reverse, samples will also pitch up and down sort of like tape. So if we take this one, for example, you'll notice that as I play it higher, it'll get shorter, and as I play it lower, it'll play for a longer time. And that's how most samplers work, sort of like digital tape, but Blackbox also lets you time stretch and pitch shift clips, meaning that they will play at the same rate, regardless of the pitch you play them at, or you can play them at the same pitch at different lengths. I loaded up this project to give you an idea of how clips behave. So each of these is a sample loop that has its own independent tempo. This guy is at 122 BPM, and I know this guy has a different tempo, say 120, and then these that are 110. Right, they're playing at their different tempos as long as the project isn't running. But if I hit play, then when I trigger a loop, right, now it plays at the overall project tempo or preset tempo. So if I change that up, it could go faster. The loop will play faster as well. If I turn the tempo down, the loop will play slower. And now I can combine different loops that were originally at different tempos to play together, all tempo aligned. And then if I change the song tempo again, they will all stay in sync. Right, so this is time stretching. keeping the pitch at the same position and changing the time a loop plays, Blackbox can also change pitch while maintaining the time. So let's get these loops going again. All right, let's get these two. And this is more tonal, so we'll change its pitch. All right, if I go into here and pitch it up, right, it will stay at the same tempo, but we'll have a different pitch. Obviously, this works across a relatively small pitch range, but still works quite nicely. So that is the clip sample type. Slicer lets you take a loop and chop it up into its various transients, or chop it up any other way you like. So for example, I could take this loop, right? Let's maybe get it back to its original pitch, or maybe a bit lower just for fun, right? So I can go ahead and slice this in a few ways. One way is just to scan it or look for transients. And you can see the result is these different sections. Notice these different slice points here. And then you can choose and play either the first, or if I go into the parameters here and choose to assign a MIDI channel to this, let's say channel 3, I'll activate channel 3 here. Then check out what happens now. Every key in the keyboard plays a different slice of the loop. Now, if I don't like these automatically detected slice points, I can always go ahead and edit them. So I can join two slices just by tapping join. Now the slice point is gone, and I can create a new one by tapping split, and you can do that at any point. So if I wanted to say split this sample right here, I just tap split, and now I have a new slice point. You can also slice it up into an equal grid if you like, and you can go up to 128 slices on this. Another cool feature of Slicer is slice sequencing. Once you turn that on, let me show you it here, right? It will play the slices consecutively every time it gets a sequence trigger or a play trigger. And there are a few options here. You can either play them forward, backwards, randomly, right? So it works like this, choosing a different slice every time. And there's also a stagger mode, which is sort of like a slightly drunken travel through the sample. One final note, when comparing slicers to clips or samples, slicers and clips have up to 2-note polyphony, and with samples, you can play up to 4 samples polyphonically per pad. All right, so those are the 3 types of sample pads. We talked about loading samples from the SD card. Let's talk about sampling. For that, you just need to pick an empty slot, and then once you press info, you can see levels of incoming audio over here. You can also set gain if you like. And I've got SWN here helping me out with sampling. I can just play notes in here. Now, sampling can either be threshold based, right? So I can set the threshold, say, at minus 20 dB. That's fine. The minute you want to get ready to record, just hit record and play. I can turn off the metronome if I wanted. I've got it running now. And then the minute audio crosses the threshold, recording will start. I've got that in here. Can just play it, and of course edit, slice, and so on, just like I would any other sample. Another cool thing that Blackbox can do is act as a live looper for your project. So let me give you an example. I've got this simple beat going. Now I can select any empty pad. I'll go into this one, turn off threshold recording, and once I do that, I can quantize recording to anything I want, but let's just pick one bar, right? Because that's what I want to show you in this project. And then I can have a different loop length. I can have it custom, so it'll stop recording once I hit record, or just say record 2 bars. And then check this out. See? Blackbox started and then stopped recording precisely in time with the project. Another nice thing that Blackbox can do, as I mentioned before, is record control voltage. So I will unplug SWN and plug in maths here. Now if I go to my sampling window, you can already see the control voltage levels coming in through here. So let's say if I shut both these cycles off, you can see they stop. And then if I turn one on, one is going and the other is going on here. And yeah, I can turn threshold recording on or off. Let's just make this a custom length recording. I don't need quantization here. Yeah, and just hit record. Okay. Now, it'll record these changes. Maybe I'll stop the looping for a second so that you can see it in the sample later on. Turn on looping, change the rate, slow it down, make it faster. You can even hear that. Okay, so that's enough. Now, if I go in and look at the sample, you can see everything that was going on from a control voltage perspective. You've got a global view of the sample over here, and you can zoom in and out to the individual waveform. Now, this sampled control voltage can then be sent out to control whatever you want, which I think is a pretty neat feature for Blackbox. So that, in a nutshell, is the pads page. The rest are much simpler, I promise you, except maybe what's going on here. Keys lets you play the sample. We saw that before. You can transpose up and down to play in different octaves. Let's talk about the sequences page. Maybe I'll just load up the original or busier project. Let's go into here and into sequences. So the sequences page has 16 slots for sequences. Now, these sequences, each sequence can play any one of the pads on the pads page. So you aren't limited to one sequence per pad, but rather each can control numerous or play numerous pads. Let me explain how you manage this. We'll start with a brand new empty sequence slot and dive in. A sequence has two views, pads or keys. Pads gives you a global view of all 16 pads and you can sequence them here. So for example, if I wanted my kick to play every four steps, I would just set that here, hit play. Right? Works quite simply. You can also zoom in and out if you like. So if you've got fat fingers like me, you might want to do that. And if I wanted to add a snare, I could say do that. And I know, right? I've got this going. So that's pads view. You can see and sequence notes in all 16 pads here. But what if I wanted to sequence a melodic pattern? For that, I'd need to dive into keys view, which gives me a piano roll. Now I need to select the pad that I want this piano roll to look into here. So let's say I want to play this one, which as you remember is this bass, right? So now I go into keys, select this pad. And now the notes that I add here will correspond to that particular, right? A slightly bassy melody, but I think you get the idea. Now, entering notes via zooming in and out isn't that convenient, obviously. Let me just clear this guy out. Luckily, you can also play notes live with a keyboard and enter them that way. Now remember, I need to assign what my keyboard does, so I need to go into here and then set that to say, again, MIDI channel 1. Set the keyboard to MIDI channel 1. And now if I go back to my sequence, I can just hit record play, right? And you can also see the notes here as well, or dive in and see them here. Now, if I set my keyboard to one of the global channels, which means that every key plays a different pad, I could record that as well, right? So I could just turn on recording. Right, now I've got that. You can also see that, by the way, in this sort of little mini representation of the sequence. Sequences are also quite flexible in that they can play at different rates. So I can change the step length, right? To play in triplets, or play each step real fast, or real slow. I can change the step count in a sequence as well. Right, you can see that over here. Now you'll notice that even though I set my step count to 8, there's this slight delay because looping is still set to quantize. If I disable quantization, then it'll just play in a loop at the length that I set it to. So that's a really nice way to create both polyrhythmic and polymetric projects. Sequences can be up to 128 steps long, and yeah, you've got a really nice range of step lengths as well, so quite a lot of flexibility in there. Aside from sequencing the pads, each sequence can also control external MIDI devices. So let's start a new sequence just for that. Note, by the way, that a sequence is active when it has a white border around it. So if I want to deactivate the sequence, just tap here. Let's go back to this one, dive in. And then if I go into the sequence settings, I can choose a MIDI out channel. Let's just choose MIDI out 1. One small thing about the way MIDI sequencing is done, at least in this firmware, the sequence will also trigger whatever pad it's associated with or wherever you program notes. So you want to make sure that the pad that you're sequencing is empty or just mute it in the mix. So I can go in here, let's say I'll choose this pad, right? So I'll be using this pad as the one I'm sending out to MIDI as well. Now if I go back into my sequence and choose keys and then use this pad, which is the pad that I just muted, then notes that I play here won't be played on the pad, but rather on whatever device I'm connected to. So I will just sequence a few random notes and hit play. And we are now hearing buzzy playback, the notes that I just sequenced in here. And I can change that. You can see MIDI coming in through here. I can, of course, change whatever's going on here, add effects and so on. So that's how you create MIDI clips to control external devices. So that is how you program the sequences, and you can have up to 16 different sequences per preset or project. So how do you make this all work into a song or performance? You can do that just like I did at the beginning of this video, just by activating sequences. If they're quantized, they'll play on the next quantization segment, right? So you can perform that way, and that's fine. But Blackbox also lets you create songs. Songs are made out of sections. You need to activate song mode for the sections to play through. And let's just hear this out. Hit play. You can see this is section number 1. Right? Section number 2. Cool. So the sections will just play one after the other, and you can also choose to loop a section, and it'll just keep looping until you disable looping. So what is a section? Well, let's start with what it's not. It's not just which sequences will play and which sequences won't play. It's actually a little bit more complex than that. A section to a sequence is sort of like what a sequence is to a pad. Ideally, by the way, there would be a piano roll view for the sections. There isn't. The way that you program sections is by first setting their length. So this section is set, for example, to 4 bars. Now, during these 4 bars, you can determine which sequences will play or not. Let me start by loading up maybe a slightly simpler project. So let's hear this simple song out first. It has 2 parts, simple bass section, and then bass and hi-hats. Right? Pretty simple and trivial. Now let's look at it on the sequences page. So I hit play, right? We've got this guy playing, and then section 2 starts, where both of them are playing. Now I built this progression in 2 sections, but I could have actually done it differently. So let's delete these 2, right? And start fresh. I'll just clear this, right? I'll set this to be, let's say, 8 bars, which is fine. Then go into sequences view, make sure the sequences are off, and then I hit record. And now it's going to start recording whatever events happen over here. So I just started the bass and I added the hi-hats, and let's take the bass out and then maybe bring it back in. Right, so that is now my section. Now if I want to play it back, I'll turn off these sequences, hit play, bass starts, then hi-hats come in. Right, and you can literally see when I pressed these, those events are recorded as part of the section. Right, so that's how you build a song in Blackbox. You just add new sections. You can, of course, rename them, as you wish. Right, part two. And then record your sequencer events. So that is the song section. The rest is pretty easy. Effects lets you apply effects to the different pads. So now I'm controlling this pad. No effects are applied to it. You've got either delay or reverb. You can press info to see the parameters of the delay as well as the reverb. And then if I wanted to send this to the reverb, I just do this. And if I wanted to send it to the delay, just add that here. Right, pretty simple and straightforward. Effects sends for all the pads. And if I want to edit, say, the reverb parameters, just do that here. You've got simple controls for the reverb as well as for the delay. The mix tab lets you control the level and panning of your different pads. Again, pretty straightforward. As I showed you before, pressing info lets you turn mutes on and off for the different pads. Preset lets you load and save presets or projects. Again, quite simple. Load up and play. One limitation that's important to note, you can't currently transition between presets seamlessly. So parts of the new one will play and then it will sort of stabilize, but it does take about a second to move from one preset to the next. The final page is the tools page. This has a few parameters you can control, a few general settings like headphone level, compressor, and whether the metronome plays or not. A few more things. Last feature I wanted to discuss is modulation. For that, I'll load up a simple single cycle waveform. And these work quite nicely with this. Let's say just load whatever. A nice little feature here is that it identifies that it's a single cycle waveform and loops it. Anyway, so what I wanted to show you was that you can apply modulation to a few of the parameters here. Modulation can be applied to any parameter that has these black rectangles below it. So for example, by default, level is modulated by the velocity with which you hit a key. Let me just turn this on to gate mode so that you can hear it, right? So if I hit hard, you get that. If I hit softly, you get this. Now I could, for example, do that to pitch as well. So I'll just hit a mod slot, let's say this one, and choose a mod source. Now there aren't that many. Right now it's mainly these expressive controls, but let's say I'll choose mod wheel, right? And then choose an amount. Now, as I touch the mod wheel, pitch will go up. And I could take this to an extreme depth. Right now, like I said before, currently there aren't that many mod sources. It's really velocity, pitch bend, mod wheel, MIDI volume, and MIDI pan. And there aren't that many destinations. So for example, you can't use ADSR as destinations. Even the filter isn't a modulatable destination. So let's talk about pros and cons. On the pros side for Blackbox is how easy it is to use compared to how powerful it is. If you consider what Blackbox does, sampling, slicing, looping, time stretching, sequencing, multi-timbre polyphony, that on its own is a lot. Now, add to that the fact that these features are so accessible is something that's quite rare. If you're into generative soundscapes or polyrhythmic sequencing, Blackbox is a dream come true, letting you launch different length sample loops and sequence with ease. The Ableton Live style grid, both for launching loops as well as sequencing, is very intuitive and flexible as a tool for music making. With a small form factor, multiple outputs and inputs, as well as small size, there's just a lot of value packed into Blackbox, and it's very eurorack friendly as well. On the cons side, unless you play live using an external keyboard or controller, the touchscreen is a relatively small interface for piano roll style sequencing. That's where other hardware sequencers with dedicated per-step buttons support a quicker workflow. In addition, from a parameter sequencing perspective, the sequencer in Blackbox is relatively simple compared to other sample playback style grooveboxes like the Electron Machines, Novation Circuit, or the Korg Electribes. While it does support flexible sequence lengths and timings with unlimited sample sizes, which you don't get on a lot of other machines, the sequencer in Blackbox, at least as of version 1.0, is just a note sequencer. You can't sequence any other parameters on it with the exception of velocity if you play with an external keyboard. So if you wanted, for example, to sequence changes in the filter over time or changes in the ADSR parameters, you can't do that, at least not in the current version of the sequencer. That said, Blackbox is a mashup of two eurorack modules from 1010Music, Toolbox and Bitbox, and since those platforms are very similar, one could expect that additional features from both those modules would eventually find their way here. Hopefully they can all grow together. The good news is that on what can't be changed, which is the hardware, the physical input and output selection, touchscreen, and the controls, all of that is excellent and there's a lot to choose from. If you want to learn more about synthesis, as well as a deeper comparative analysis for hardware like this, check out my ever-expanding book, available to people who support this channel on Patreon. Feel free to ask me any questions below, hit like if this was useful, and ring the notification bell after subscribing if you want to make sure you don't miss the next one. Thanks very much for watching.